In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. One of the greatest tricks that the devil ever pulled was to convince the world that he didn't exist. In this way, that wicked serpent, that great enemy of God and man, that creature of the shadows, has been able to work his craft in the dark and spread his venom among the children of Adam. And so it is today that his doctrine is often taught in the universities or the schools and in the media under some more benign sounding name, such as progress or social justice or the science with a capital S and a trademark over the E. Now, to be clear, I'm not saying that science is bad, but we all know that the science very often means little more than what the opinions of the ones speaking about it are, that it has very little to do with actual science. That crafty creature in the beginning, with poisonous words, disrupted the harmony and unity between man, woman, and God, introduced distrust, discord, division, and death. And so he plies the same trade today, poisoning the hearts of men with nihilism or atheism or gender ideology and racism, either in its newfangled form of CRT or in its good old-fashioned kind, turning neighbor against neighbor, man against man, husband against wife, and ultimately, all of us against our loving Creator. Whether one believes in him or not does not actually matter very much. For in this present evil age, he is served, and he is served well. His creed is the creed of our own times. It is not thy will be done, Father in heaven, but do as thou wilt. Not be true unto God, but be true unto thine own self, with all of your own disordered desires, lusts, and passions. Not seek ye first the kingdom of heaven, but seek ye first thine own kingdom. And this is why our culture is so enthralled to the beast that we ironically pay homage to him in music videos, erect statues of the horned Baphomet with children on his lap, and have faux worship of him at the Grammys. Major media corporations like CBS tweeting out, "Ready to worship," as transgender go-go dancers exalt a gender-fluid pop star in satanic attire. This is why we have the Satanic Temple declaring abortion to be a sacrament and then suing states on religious freedom grounds to allow abortion. It is not that all these people are theological Satanists. It's not that they actually believe in the devil. But they grab onto and they cling to his symbols and his image because they recognize that his project is the same as theirs. Perhaps I quote it a little too often, but I cannot help it, because it is such a restive word from our Lord that can pull us out of our slumber. Jesus says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who practices sin is a slave to sin. You are of your father the devil, and your will is to do your father's desires." Jesus speaks these shocking words not to a congregation of Satanists, not to a coven of witches, not even to Greek pagans, but to Israelites who will not accept his word. Indeed, he says, "Whoever is of God hears the word of God. The reason why you do not hear me or hear them is that you are not of God." Whether one believes in the devil or not, if they are not in Jesus, they are a child of the father of lies. Nonetheless, those are the ones precisely whom Jesus died for and calls to himself, calls to be reconciled to God, precisely those whom we are called to preach the gospel to. So we are not called to be woke, but we are called to be awake to the works of the devil in the world, to see his works in the light of the holy apostolic scriptures. You have an enemy, an adversary, Satan, who is ceaselessly spreading ever more sin, error, blindness, and darkness, misery and misfortune. Broken families, depressed children, empty churches, these are his goals. The scriptures shine their bright light on him so that he cannot hide in the shadows anymore. They say he is the prince of the power of the air and that he prowls around like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. He is at work in the sons of disobedience and has blinded the mind of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light, the gospel of the glory of Christ. Paul says we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. And so our gospel text this morning tells us two more things that we should know about the devil. First, that Christ has battled him and has conquered. And second, how Christians, by the power of Christ, might overcome him. In today's gospel, the battle between Christ and the devil begins in earnest. Christ has just been baptized in that glorious scene with the heavens opening up and the Spirit descending upon him. Like a dove for all to see, the voice of the Father has rung out like thunder from heaven. This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. And Christ, according to his own words, has stepped into the Jordan, into the place of sinners to fulfill all righteousness. He has begun his substitutionary work, and immediately he is led out by the Spirit into the wilderness to do battle with our great and ancient foe. All of Israel, all of mankind, reduced to one man, the God-man Jesus Christ. Yes, Paul declares, if because of one man's trespass, death reigned through that one man, much more will those who receive the abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Like David of old, the offshoot, the offspring of David, now stands against hell's Goliath. In David, we see a type of Christ, the Philistines, that menacing army, sent out their champion, the giant Goliath. And he came out with this challenge. If Goliath should triumph over Israel's champion, Israel would be the Philistines' slaves. But if Israel should triumph over Goliath, the Philistines will be their slaves. Goliath menaced them with taunts and insults. He shamed them from the plain and with his mighty spear and shield and armor. But then that shepherd lad, David, from Bethlehem, small, young, altogether unimpressive, armed with only a few stones, took his challenge, took the field to fight for all of Israel against that mighty foe, and with one stone crushed the head of the giant. His victory was Israel's victory. And so the good shepherd, the son of Bethlehem, Jesus our Lord, comes in weakness to stand before the dragon. As we sang in Luther's great hymn today, his royal power disguised he bore, a servant's form like me he wore, to lead the devil captive. In Jesus, the devil who had conquered man was conquered by man. The greater Goliath conquered by David's greater son. Yes, ancient prophecy is ultimately fulfilled in the cross. The serpent there would bruise Christ's heel, but Christ would crush him with his death. The mighty battle begins here, and the first skirmish is won in the temptation. And not won by Jesus for himself, but won by Jesus for us. Standing as our representative, the new Adam, through whom all the sons and daughters of God would be born. He succeeded where the first Adam failed. He is not in paradise with plenty to eat, but in the wilderness, fasting for 40 days. And yet he refuses the devil's offer of food, when Adam did not. The serpent in the garden undermined Adam and Eve's trust in the word of God with the question, did God really say? But Christ responds without wavering, it is written. Where Adam and Eve succumb to the temptation of glory and pride, Jesus refuses the glory of all the kingdoms of the earth, instead choosing the glory of obedience to the Father through an ignominious death on the cross. Christ triumphed. He commanded Satan to leave, and the devil? he had to leave defeated. Dearly beloved, your heavenly general has won the day. Nothing more is required of you than what was required of the army of Israel when they faced the Philistines. You are the believing spectator, watching your champion defeat hell's Goliath, and he shares the spoils of victory with you. You are free of the devil's tyranny, no matter how deeply you had previously succumbed to it. Side with Christ, and you are victor over sin and hell. And Christ your Lord divides those spoils of war with you: forgiveness of sins, righteousness, life, and salvation. The victory is won for you by Christ. Now, though, you have joined the banner of the cross. You stand on the side of victory, and now it is time to take up spiritual arms, to put on the full armor of God and pursue the defeated foe. Our Lord Christ says, "The gates of hell shall not prevail against my church." That is not to say that the church will merely survive the wrath of hell. Certainly, that is true. But rather that the church militant is now on the ramparts, storming that fortress, and those infernal gates will not hold. Hell and its prince will not survive the fury of heaven. As St. Paul says, the God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet. We wield the word of God, which is a powerful two-edged sword. With law, we come to expose sin, and with the gospel, we come to set the captives free. And here is the second use of today's gospel lesson. Yes, of first importance is that Christ has taken the field and he has won the victory. But second, by his example, he shows us how to prosecute the war. Whoever has been made victorious by Christ will also fight as he did. You have been called up into active duty, into spiritual warfare. God is called the Lord God of Sabaoth because he is at the head of the leader of the angel armies and also the armies of his saints. And so we see in today's text both the devil's cunning in his threefold temptation of Jesus, but we also see how he is overcome. First, the devil appeals to Jesus' need and hunger. If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread. He seeks to make Jesus question his Father's love for him and God's provision for his needs. Can you truly be the Son of God if you are in such distress? Or is God really good? Satan's first temptation is to make Christians despair on account of poverty or want or sickness or depression or misfortune, to make the Christian doubt God's care and provision. When this temptation fails, he moves on to the next trick. He twists God's word. He rips it from context. He says, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you. And on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone." Completely ignoring what follows, "Because he holds fast to me in love, I will deliver him. I will protect him, because he knows my name." Here the devil takes a passage about the faithfulness of the Messiah to the Father and tries to induce Jesus with it to put his Father to the test. This is the second trick of the devil. He tries to use God's own word to undermine God's word. He twists it, he distorts it, he uses one partial truth to bring in 10 lies. Some true dough mixed with leaven to sneak the leaven in to leaven the whole lump. But again, this temptation fails, and he turns to his third trick. He points to all the kingdoms of the world and their glory and says, "All these I will give to you." He tempts you to throw away your heavenly treasure for earthly fame, wealth, and glory, the eternal for the temporal, incorruptible joy, for the pursuit of corruptible lusts. Three keys the devil uses to enter the human heart: hardship, false doctrine, and earthly glory or sensuous pleasure. And all three are overcome in the same way. It is written, it is written, it is written. That great and ancient foe may be wiser than we, stronger and smarter too, but he is no match for the Word of God. By it he is overcome. So, dear Christians, make the Word of God your weapon. Before it, the devil must flee. His darkness cannot stand in the light, and his lies are revealed by the truth. Learn from your Satan, Savior, not from your Satan. Learn from Jesus, your Savior, how to overcome Satan's attacks and answer. It is written, when trouble and distress befall you and the devil makes you doubt God's love, respond. It is written, man does not live on bread alone, but by every word of the mouth of God. It is written, all things work together for the good of those who love God. It is written, what you meant for evil, God meant for good. When the devil twists God's word and says, it is written, you respond, yes, and it is also written here and here and here. And when he entices you by worldly passions and glory, respond, it is written, whoever makes a practice of sinning is of the devil, for the devil has been sinning from the beginning, and the wages of sin is death. And so this Lent, let us know that Christ has conquered the devil for us. And if we choose to give up chocolate or meat or fast in any way, let it also be the case that we take up the Word of God in the church and at home, so that to every assault and purpose of the devil, we may answer, be gone, Satan, it is written, you have been defeated. Amen. May rise for the offertory.